Is that a new one?
Which one? It's from a song.
Is it that Jamaican?
Yeah, that's how he starts
Jamaican
it off.
Gospel. You know, yard, Flash, yard. You know?
Really? And I'll send you the song. How can he start saying "Praise be to the Lord"?
I know the one you're talking about. How does it go? Like the chorus or something.
It's quite fast paced, like the from start to finish.
Okay,
it's very fast paced. Yeah, I'll put it in the group chat.
Praise be to the Lord, my. I don't know why, guys, go on. Sorry.
The one I remembered. Under the blood, and under the blood.
Under the blood, send me under the blood. Under the blood, send me under the blood. No, because literally.
Under the blood, me say under the blood.
Okay.
Under the blood, me say under the blood.
Under the blood, under the blood. This is really powerful.
Do you know what? It's so powerful.
It is. And like, it just, obviously, the same way we have Afro Gospel and we have Nathaniel Batty Johnson. Of course, they have their own.
Right,
they have. I just didn't know.
Maybe because you're just not used to it.
I'm not part
you're
of that.
Because I'm not. Sometimes when I hear, I'm like, whoa.
Yeah, like, do you know what I mean? I'm just not part of that culture.
Do you know what I think it is? I think maybe because, you know, gospel has its own genre, right? Regardless of like the country you're from, gospel has a genre. Right. You can sing gospel in Chinese, you can speak, but it's still a gospel genre. Mm-hmm. So I think like Nigerians, we do it with like not worldly instrumentals, but we can use like, for example, other genres and incorporate gospel into it. So
right,
like,
okay,
with reggae, like imagine hearing a reggae beat and you hear a gospel song, your brain will take a while to like
register
what it is. I think it might be that,
maybe,
because yeah, I think that's what it might
maybe
be.
That's it, because I'm just not, do you know, I'm not gonna lie, it's not the beat, it's the accent.
Oh,
fair.
I'm just not used to it.
Fair enough.
I'm not,
you know what, some
it.
Caribbeans probably feel that way about Afro gospel.
Do you think
so?
Probably, maybe, especially if you haven't grown up with that music, because remember, a lot of people maybe a large number of people only started listening to Afro beats when it became popular. So if you haven't grown up with a certain type of music, when you hear it, it's like, oh wow, it's a new sound.
That's
not
fair.
The oh wow.
No, because fair. Actually, I have a question on this then.
Mm-hmm.
How are you guys feeling about gospel music in general? Like, are you enjoying it at the moment?
Loving it.
Wow.
I am.
Okay, go on.
I'm loving it. Right. I've transitioned. I used to be a heavy like old school R&B listener. Okay. But I've transitioned from that being like my main playlist that I listen to Christian R&B. And shout out to the artist.
Tell
Madison
us, who are they?
Madison Ryan Ward, Jor’dan Armstrong, okay, Ryan Ofe.
Ofe, yeah.
Ofe, off the top of my head, Aja Walls as well. There's just like a heap of artists that are like, if you look, you'll find it.
Yeah,
you will. You genuinely will. And it's just been, that's been my main playlist.
Literally, I'm looking forward to my Spotify on Rapture, because I'm not gonna lie to you guys, for the last however many years I've been on Spotify, every year Afrobeats is number one. If it's not Afrobeats, then it's I feel like it's classic UK rap or something.
Okay.
Something like that. But this year, my music has, like, the way I listen to music has changed so much. If you know me, you know I used to know every new Afrobeats. Everything.
That's true, actually.
That
was
me. Now,
what's changed?
Life has changed. I don't know. I feel like after going on my proper music, like fast, changing it completely, listening to gospel music for a very long time, my appetite for music has changed a lot. Like,
that will change it.
I literally, if you were to ask me what I listen to on a daily basis, it's solely Christian music. And even to the point, like, before it used to be like, okay, maybe if I'm going somewhere, if I'm in a different space, I might listen to a different genre of music. But now I just listen to different genres of Christian music.
Yes.
Like, only. There are obviously times that I might listen to one song here or there. Do you know what I mean? Like, but on the whole, it's just
your main listening
Christian
is
music.
Yep.
And I'm not gonna lie to you, like Ashley said, if you go searching, like, if you look,
you'll find
so
such
many,
good
you've got
artists.
Forrest Frank in one end,
love
then you've
him.
Got like, who's the person? You've got Transformation Worship, you've got Maverick City, you've got so many different,
so
types of
many
music.
Different
you've
people.
You've got Nathaniel Bassey, if you really like that type of music, Dancing Oyeka, and you've got Ryan Ophi, like, I love Ryan Ophi, and Limo Blaze. You've got so many people,
even Christian rappers as well. Like, there's so
Jackie Hill Perry,
her new EP, Lecrae, Triple Lee, there's so many, Andy Mineo, there's so many people. If you look, you'll find.
No, 100%. Do you know what? This is the year I've listened to gospel music the most. And I feel like, there's been a transition as well, like, recently. I'll be very surprised if my Spotify, I'm not a Spotify.
Apple Music.
Oh, but okay.
I'd be surprised if my Apple Music came back with my top three wouldn't be gospel, because again, it's always on repeat. Mm-hmm. But I'm not really in the R&B gospel phase. I think, do you know, recently, I have been banging out Yoruba gospel. Mm. Oh my god, I don't know what's changed, I don't know what's happened.
Oh, but I love that.
Yoruba gospel has always been Yoruba gospel to me, but as of this year, I took it to a whole nother level. Finding the same way, you know, actually finding new artists, you know, with different genres of gospel. So am I.
Please, like, tell us all.
Mm-hmm. So there's an art. Let the people know. Called, the name is M or OMG. I don't know if you've heard of them. Oh my god!
He makes like the Christian remixes as well. He's the one that said, you know that song that wasn't popular. He's like, I'm in the presence of my.
Yes. No wonder I thought the name sounds familiar.
Oh my god. I thought they were a choir. To be honest,
it's a guy, and I think he has a choir.
I was watching a music video of him yesterday. Actually, funny enough. I've listened to that. Moses Bliss, I've heard some of his songs recently. Very Moses good. Bliss. He's amazing. Yes. Dunson.
Wake up.
Wow, let the worshiper in you wake up. I think he had a concert just end of summer, but the tickets sold out in two seconds. Right. I remember you spoke about it.
Yeah. You were telling us.
And I really wanted to go, but tickets sold out. But I've been listening to Nathaniel Bassey, of course. Mm-hmm. Like, do you know what I mean?
Just an OG. Sumisola.
Who's Sumisola?
She's got that very powerful voice. I don't know.
Yeah.
She's done a rendition of that song.
Okay.
And but she's like, obviously she's Nigerian, so it's just different.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know, like, her voice is very powerful. No, there's just a lot of them.
There's a lot.
There's so many.
What? It slaps.
It slaps differently.
I feel like when you listen to music in your mother tongue, it just slaps.
Yeah, it's different. Congolese gospel, Seben, all of that. It's just different. Yeah.
I don't know, it just feels heavily spiritual. Like.
Yeah, there's a Congolese and South African gospel song that I really love. I forgot how it goes, but oh my God, like, it's so powerful. I don't know some of the words, but you can just tell. Mm-hmm. Like the power in just the lyrics and just the harmonizing, everything is so angelic.
Mm-hmm. And that's the thing, so I think the reason why you can resonate with like a different language of worship is because it's universal. It's the Lord's love.
There you go. You translate it through music.
So it does not matter the language.
Yeah.
You'll feel the Holy Spirit. Yeah.
Literally.
The Spirit.
I'm trying to remember the Congolese and South African one, but for some reason it's not coming. But
is it two female artists?
No.
Okay.
It's a choir. It's like a group of people just singing. And actually, you've probably heard it before. You probably know the one I'm talking about, but I just need to remember the name. Okay. It's so powerful.
When you find it,
let us know.
No, definitely.
I have another question, because I feel like my journey with music has been a long one, because for the longest time I was like, I don't need to only listen to Christian music. Like, I can listen to everything.
Mm.
And I do want to make a distinction, because I think sometimes we talk about secular music as if all secular music is bad. Right. I don't think that. I don't subscribe to that camp, because Happy Birthday is a secular song and we're going to sing it every time. Secular literally just means not, it's not faith-based.
Right.
There's a difference between secular and worldly, or secular and carnal, or sinful music.
Right.
I feel like there's a need to really explain that, because I think you have a lot of love songs. They're not necessarily Christian songs, but
they speak of love in messaging a positive light.
Is everything.
Mm-hmm.
And so for me, I feel like I'll always be on the side of like, music is a way that God gets glory, whether it has Christian like written on it. God created music like as a whole. But I know that for the last few years, my journey with music has been challenging, because I always used to preach to people, I'm not gonna lie, I always used to say to people, no, music is powerful. Like, it will influence your brain, it will influence your 100%. heart, and it will influence your speech. Like, if it influences every part of your life, but I think for the longest time I was resistant to like making a big switch like I've made now.
Yeah.
But I proper see the difference that it makes.
No, there's a big difference. Do you know, I feel like we've been similar in that sense where...
Are you enjoying this episode? If you are and you're not subscribed, what are you doing? Go down below and subscribe. Make sure you follow us on our Instagram and our TikTok, Sitting Down with the Sisters.
I hold the same opinion. If it's not negative per se, and obviously it's not vulgar music, like, music can still be positive without it being sinful. Mm-hmm. However, with that being said, how, I think when we start characterizing what's good and what's bad and what falls under which category, the line becomes really thin. So I feel like that's why personally I kind of just, and I'm not going to sit here and say I don't listen to any circular music at all. Mm. It's just like we said previously, like my main playlist or like my main day-to-day music will be Christian music, because there is a difference and I recognize the difference, especially when you take a break from listening to circular music, whatever it may be, whether it's a positive message or say if it's not a positive message, and then you take a break and you're listening to Christian music and then you go back to listen to circular music, I feel like my spirit is a lot more sensitive, and when I hear this, like the words of certain songs, I'm like, that's what I was listening to before.
My body literally rejects it.
I'm like, I'm not gonna, I have to like press next, and I'm like, oh no, I can't listen to that. Like, my ears are sensitive. I'm like, wow, like,
this is what I can't. I was listening to
before, yeah, these are the words that I was listening to. Yeah. Like, it's not really.
And you know what? Sometimes, like, there's two different types of people. I feel like when it comes to music, some people. They always take in the lyrics they listen to, but whether they listen to it or not, that's not, you know, the point. They still take in the lyrics. Mm-hmm. And there are other people like me, where when the vibes is vibesing and the instrumentals are popping, I'm just dancing. I'm not taking in the words you're saying sometimes, you know? And I remember doing a fast sometime this year, and it wasn't just a music fast, just a fast in general, where like no social media for like, I did it for like a few days. And I remember when I got back to sort of normal activities and I just put on, I don't remember what song it was. I think it happened to be a Rema song or something. I just happened to put on a song and I was driving, and the way my mouth dropped,
because you finally took in the lyrics, isn't it?
I took in the lyrics, and then I looked down at my phone and I saw the artwork of the cover of the album I was listening to. I said, what have I been consuming in my ear? Yeah. And I'm never the type, like every time I got that conviction in the past, I would never sort of skip the song. I'll just listen to it because it's still right. But as of recently, I feel like I've been praying, like beginning of this year, I've been asking God to speak to me directly to me, just so, and not just speak to me. I want him to allow me to recognize it's him speaking, this like his distinctive voice. I want to know. And I feel like God has been doing that recently. And if I'm not listening, why would he continue telling me what to do? Right. Mm. If I'm not paying attention, why would he continue to tell me what to do? Mm-hmm. Or do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So I'm taking it upon myself to be obedient. So then he continues to talk to me more. To you, so how can I be praying for something contradicting my prayer?
Right. Right.
Do you get it? So now when I would listen to music and it just, the minute it doesn't feel right, I can't help but skip it. Do you know what it is? A lot of the time when I do listen to music, I might be driving or working out or doing something. So let's say I am driving, I can't delete it right away, so I might forget. But the minute I remember the song, I don't just skip it and now have to find time to delete it. So take it doesn't it come back. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of like, I'm becoming more spiritual with time, and there's a lot of things I think I used to take for granted. Mm. There's a lot of things that I never saw in the spiritual realm or took too seriously in terms of the content that I allow, you know, I absorb into my body, like just the things that I take in. I think
you're picking up on it.
I've got to gatekeep more and I've started to do that a lot more. Like music, circular music, like I said, it's, you can, there's a variety that you can't just put it in one big bracket and say it's all bad. But I think if we become, especially if you're Christian, if you become more aware and alert of the things that you let in and the music you listen to, you'll realize like a lot of them, they're just not right.
I was gonna say that because I feel like a lot of people, because that's the thing, that's the argument. The argument is, yeah, but it doesn't do it to me. Like, I remember when I used to have a conversation with one of my close friends, he always used to be like, yeah, but it's not that deep. And like recently he actually came and opened up to me. He was like, oh, you know what you told me like a few years ago, like it's so true. Especially certain type
that's
of music.
That's me, I'm that person too.
Like there's certain type of music, like especially like he specifically was listening to, not to drag him, yeah, when he hears it you understand, but there's people like Lil Uzi, Playboi Carti, certain types of music that I'm like, you know, as you're even if you feel like it's not doing anything to you, what it's just making you, it's making
subconsciously
you susceptible to other things. Like I don't know how to explain it. There's people that you listen to music, it makes you angry, and then you end up doing things you don't want to do. Or you listen to music, it makes you feel lustful, and you're wondering like, why am I struggling with this one thing? And it might not be because in that moment it might not lead you to do something in that very moment, but it's something that's sitting residually in the back. It's like,
and it just needs a trigger, it just needs something to make it alive.
Like there's a Bible verse that talks about how a little a little leaven leavens the whole lump, which means basically like yeast in bread. Yeah, there's only a little bit of yeast, but it's that tiny little bit of yeast that makes it rise.
Right.
So when you allow a little bit of sin, whether it's worldly music, whether it's worldly, even shows, yeah, because listen, shows.
We'll come on to that one next.
But when it's like, it feels like it's insignificant because it does, because you feel like it's just a song. Do you know what I mean? But repetition, the power of repetition. What does the Bible tell us to, what's that word? Meditate on things. When you're having things repetitively just
over
going
and over
mind,
and over again,
that's a form of meditation.
Yep.
But it doesn't feel like that because it's just a song, it's 3 minutes, like it doesn't matter. But as the Bible verse says, a little leaven, like sin, when it enters your life, it has the power to corrupt it. Like it's like a disease, it just starts to infect.
It's a domino effect.
So if you're just saying in the one way, it was just a little bit, you don't realize the power. Not that sin is ever powerful than the Lord, like let's not get that wrong, but it has the power to derail you.
Right.
Because it leavens, like it says, it rises and it just completely contaminates the 100%. Whole ecosystem. So
true. And people don't realize it, especially obviously when you make comments like, oh, it's not that deep. But like you said, if you're listening to like a certain type of music and then you're finding that you're more agitated, you don't have patience, like the way it shows up in little different ways, and you might not realize or be able to pinpoint it back to music. But what I've found as well, a lot of music, it might not be vulgar, it might not have a negative message per se, but I'm finding that a lot of music is very blasphemous these days. Like, it's even just like old music as well from bands. There's one, you know, The Script. I think that song, if you know it. I'm still alive, but I'm barely breathing. Just praying to a God that I
don't believe in. God,
sorry. I always, you know, when I sing it, I change that one.
I do believe in.
Because it's not me that is going to, you know, it's very blasphemous. Like the way they're using the Lord's name in vain, the stuff they're saying. It's just, it's very like, whoa.
It's an agenda. In music specifically, this is the thing, messaging is everywhere, whether it's media, there's music, shows, it wants you to disregard God and have less reverence for him. So it might sound like it's not that deep. It's deep.
And a lot of the time they might use the instrumental, like, you know, to derail you from the message. When you hear good instrumental,
when I hear good instrumental, this song is doing me, I'm gonna be vibes.
See that they have like the Amapiano piano now, they have the Afrobeat.
I don't understand South African. I don't understand what they're saying.
And then you're seeing the choreography, so it's even distracting you from hearing the song properly.
But the thing is, no shade to my South Africans, I love you, I'm a Pan-African. But when I see some of the dancing that happens at my piano, you're doing your eyes, like you're doing all this
like it's giving witchcraft. I'm sorry.
I'm like,
it's the same with Afrobeat. There's certain Afrobeats, Nigerian dances as well that I don't understand.
There's a song by Rema right now. Anytime I hear it, it sounds like incantation to me.
No. Rema sounds like incantations anyway.
What's happening?
I'm sorry.
We're just listening to it.
There was one song I heard the other day.
Everywhere you go, you're hearing it.
The first time I heard it, I didn't really like it. And then with time, I started to hear it. I was like, oh, this song, I want it. I like it. I like this song.
I need it. I need it.
I downloaded the phone without even realizing the name of it. I didn't even think about the name. I downloaded it, the artwork. I ignored everything just to hear the song. I'm now listening to the song and I'm driving. And I was like, wait. And then check the name. It's called Juju. And then the artwork is so... guys, I'll show it to you after. But I think it was Rema and someone else. The artwork... I don't know if it's Rema, but it's called Juju. I remember hearing it and I was thinking, this song is so popping. But then I had to delete it straight away. I was just like, you know what? There's one thing like trying to conquer all the demons and the things that I've been doing from before. Why am I adding more?
You're opening new doors
to my playlist.
Music is a ministry.
Something that God has already conquered me from. He's made me now conscious of it. And now I'm adding on to it.
Like a dog going back to his vomit. That's what we do. We don't know where we're coming from.
And it's like they're not even trying to hide it anymore. And people are seeing it. They're like, oh yeah, they're doing this, but that's not what it means. Like you're making an excuse for it. No, what they put in blatant in our faces, that's what it means.
It's Odomodu Black and Shali Poppy.
Odomodu Black.
And some guy called Smiley. Guys, sorry, I thought that song was so good, And then I start listening to him like, what's happening?
Just look at the imagery, everything. Just look at it. The thing is, people act like these things are someone not, like, it's actually very much in your face.
It is.
Like, it's incredible.
They're not and trying to hide
the
it.
The thing that came to my mind right as we were talking, I was listening to Candace Owens, like, she was talking about music one time.
Mm-hmm. Big up Candace Owens. Big up
for
Candace
real. Shout out to her.
One time for the one time.
Sorry, not sorry.
We'd love to be on your podcast, actually. Anyway,
for real. When you're in London, come through, pull up. Sit down, girl. You want to hear what you got to say.
Period. So she was talking about music, and she was talking about how, have you noticed yet? This is specifically in America because she's American. She was saying, like, especially music that, artists that make black music, there's this narrative about being hypersexual, hyperviolent, and then that becomes black music, and that is what's perpetrated. And so that is now the representation of black culture. Mm-hmm. And she was saying back in the day when she was growing up, like, we had Lauryn Hill, we had people that were talking about stuff in their music, like actual messages right. in their music. But now we have the Sexy Reds, we have the people that every single song is just vulgarity, mm-hmm. and that is now made to look as though that is the epitome.
That's the face, like, the of full black culture.
Thing of you, black culture.
Yeah.
And we, as the people consuming, not we, God forbid, but people consuming it, and, like, continuing to fund it and continuing to subscribe to it, we're just perpetuating the narrative even more. Mm.
And I think what you said at the end was actually the point I want to make and just emphasize on as well. Because back in those days, like, Lauryn Hill and all these people, they were mainstream. And I feel like with black culture and black music right now, you still have people like Lauryn Hill, but they're just not mainstream, anymore. Mm-hmm. So unfortunately, the people that are mainstream are now representing sort of black music, like the Sexy Reds and the City Girls and, you know, the Young Thugs and people like that. So my question is, how did it get to that one? Because back when Lauryn Hill was popping, so was Lil Kim. They were still sort of trending, but they weren't really, like, it was a taboo.
They were different. Mm-hmm.
There was something that Ashley said in our last episode, where something to do with order. There's order of things, yeah, and I feel like it's lost. It's been lost in translation, like, mm-hmm. recently, mm-hmm. and I don't know where it's gone wrong. Where, like, what was sort of not mainstream before has now become mainstream. It's like they've swapped roles.
Right.
Because again, it's not as if worldly music weren't always around back in those days,
mm-hmm.
but it wasn't labeled black music, or it wasn't the forefront of representation.
It was just rap.
And the same way with, like, not to go off the rails with the topic we're discussing, but with TV as well, there's certain things that weren't allowed to play after a certain time.
Mm-hmm.
So these kids wouldn't even have
the opportunity to see
and the access, because again, social media is now easily accessible and things like that. So it just, I don't know how it's become such a thing where it's so hard to find these black artists that are actually making clean music,
and why they're not pushed to the forefront.
Yeah, I don't know what's changed. Mm-hmm.
I think a lot of us are too focused on, my manager shouted at me because they're racist. And we're not focused on, in the media, they're trying to demonize the entire black race. Or they're trying to make us look degenerate. Like, why is it that...
We need to get Dr. Rima in here.
Nah, for real.
Because
there's not just a snow bunny crisis.
No, because why is it that... We are happy to support someone who made a lip gloss. Was it lip gloss line? She made a line of product.
Oh my God.
And the names were
like gonorrhea. Like, and this is things that people are doing this in the street.
And they're buying it.
And you don't see how it's
and you're
making
using
our
it.
Culture. Well, we're not African American, so maybe, I don't know. But it's making the culture that it looks degenerate. We look like we don't. People... Like, and it's like we're praising it.
Do you know what though? With that specific example, I was glad. I don't know why I'd be glad, because it should be the norm anyway. Mm. But I was glad to see there was backlash on it.
Yeah, I saw
people
the heavy
did
backlash.
Not support that
yeah.
because that was just unbearable. Mm-hmm.
But it's so like what it can come out though is insane.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like what you said. It's definitely an agenda, because I think back then, and correct me if I'm wrong, like listeners and watchers, you didn't have music executives and people from white people publicly co-signing certain music. They were more so on the side of, oh, they wanted to dismantle it, blah blah blah, whereas now you have like you have Sexy Red being invited to these, you know, like these elaborate events.
If
that
you can't bring them down, we'll
when there's certain
bad.
White people who haven't even steps foot into those places. So there's definitely gender, and I'm so glad you mentioned about TV shows, because even if you look back at the certain TV shows that we had from, you know, Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, Living Single, Sister, Girlfriends, just the black TV shows, My Wife and Kids, of healthy married couples, Marisha, not the last season, of healthy black couples, married, functioning, do you know what I mean? In a healthy dynamic. Mm-hmm. Whereas now the TV shows are, oh, they're either divorced or the black man, the black husband is cheating with someone outside of the race. There's like, it just
a lot of
the way it's shifted. Mm-hmm. It's just, it shows the black family, to take it away from music and now onto TV shows. The way they show black families is just very dysfunctional. Mm-hmm. And not all families are like that. And now they've put that at the forefront, because there's this page that I follow that they show like throwbacks of like old TV shows, and just the amount of shows that we had in the 90s and the early 2000s. Mm. Cousin Skeeter on Nickelodeon alone, we had Kenan and Kel, just healthy dynamics. Mm. That young children could see on TV. Mm. And then whereas now you don't have that anymore.
It's crazy.
It's all gone over a period of time.
Why has that changed?
It's an agenda, because I listened to Amber Rose. She was on a podcast and she was talking about how people used to literally in her camp tell her that you need to post these pictures of you in this type of way. You need to look like this because we're going to give you money. Same with Cardi B. Cardi B has vocally come out and said, this is what sells. This is what they tell me is what I should put out. Whether it's the music, the vulgar music, the type of pictures they post on their Instagram. They are told this from the higher ups, the people that they work for, because they work for these labels. This is what sells.
And then, we've spoken about something similar. It's like a supply and demand situation. Right. What's demanded is what's being supplied. Mm. So that's why I'm saying, where has the shift come from, where the consumers or the watchers or you know, the people that purchase these things, why has that now changed? Why has that become something that they want
to
see?
I do think that's an aspect of it as well, is because we've normalized toxicity.
I think
that's why you have shows like Love and Hip Hop doing so well. It's not doing so well for no reason, because there's no viewership. Their viewers, the amount of people that watch those type of shows, Baddies, Jocelyn Hernandez, her show, because people are tuning in, and the amount of money that they're making from that, and they're seeing it, they're thinking, oh, this is what's doing really well, it's successful, so let's do more. Who else can we give these type of shows so we can, again, like you said, supply the demand?
And on that, I actually think what is different to what was happening when we were growing up is people are appealing to people's, like, their lusts. So the things that before, if you were saying that this is something you wanted to see, people would be like, that's really bad, you shouldn't want to see that. Mm-hmm. We're now like catering now, it's like, to people's
lust. So normalizing what makes you happy.
The reason I mentioned power is because I don't know when we got so comfortable with having porn in normal TV, just normal porn in TV shows. Like, it's not even only power, it's a lot of shows. If you watch most shows that come out in the last few years, it's pornographic what is in the show.
Mm.
Like, you don't need to go and click onto a porn website to see 100%. Explicit content.
You will see it in day-to-day TV
five,
shows.
10 seconds in one
episode.
How many
scenes? Right. Do you know what I mean? And it's like, the reason why I think it's happening is because people are appealing to people's perversion. Mm-hmm. Like, in... But because it's now the wider society is becoming
more
perverse.
It's not taboo anymore.
Exactly. The wider society is becoming more perverse. They're able to slip everything into everything. Right. And now it's just seen as normal.
It's just normal.
And it's TV shows where it's like, is that really necessary that it needs to be in there? Whereas in comparison before, you'd have, you'd see someone, okay, you can tell that they're about to have intercourse, but it would be cut before it even happens, or they'll close the door, or there'll be music that comes on, it will go to a black screen, it will cut to that. Mm-hmm. Whereas now you full on see it, you see the person.
Nakedness.
Everything.
And at that, at broad daylight, like before, like I said, there would be like a restriction, like a time or curfew where certain shows would be shown after a certain, when the kids have gone to bed. Mm-hmm. But now that's not the case, because everything's
so
now
true,
on demand.
You know? I think that's another aspect.
You can access it whenever you feel like it. It's on your tablet, you can watch it back at any time.
Yeah.
And you can, at 2 p.m., you could literally sit on the bus watching pornography.
Mm-hmm. That's another aspect of it, it's ratings. Like, in terms of ratings behind, so from a media like behind the scenes, before a show goes out, you have to rate it based off, in this country, Ofcom or just whatever the regulations are. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of shows, they're finding ways now, whereas what before used to be a 9 p.m. or 8 o'clock afterwards, it's now 2 p.m. Or it could easily be 7 p.m. Like, they're finding ways to tweak
just
it, and
it
they're
in.
Cutting corners to slip it in.
Mm-hmm. Do you know why I think that's even happening? Because social media is accessible to anybody. The internet itself has become more accessible to anybody.
Right.
So now, because they can show it to you on the internet, it's not like being regulated by a TV channel. Mm-hmm. But now that if you're going to see it on social media, why can't we have it on TV?
Right.
Because it's on the internet. It's like, the more access you give people, like, it's like you're unleashing just the
pool
all
becomes bigger.
Forms of wildness. You can unleash it now and make it more accessible for people.
I think everything, even again, everything we discuss about just this day and age, it always goes back to social media. Like, as much as you've spoken about the positives of social media, again, there's just a lot of things that comes from social media where everything is just so easily accessible. Like, for example, you said, you know, back then it was television. A lot of our media content was on television. That's where and that was more controlled. Right. Mm-hmm. But whereas now, someone can literally watch a show, which we see all the time, Netflix. And they can record it on
a
their
clip,
phone,
yeah,
and
from and
the
post
TV,
it.
It's going to be posted on social media, and a child will see that content and they've watched a full episode without realizing.
Crazy.
Right now on TikTok, you can watch a full episode of TV shows.
Yeah,
and you don't need a television anymore.
It's so
not
sad.
As if the TV was regulated in the first place anymore, right. But now you can even see it on TikTok on your phone.
See how people screen recording.
And
you
it's really sad because there will be good shows, for instance, great shows like Bridgerton, for instance, that can have good storylines, good storytelling, but they are also infiltrating shows like that because I don't think it's good for, especially because Bridgerton has a young audience too. Mm. I don't think it's good that, especially the first season of Bridgerton, you had so much explicitness in the show. But you're also trying to appeal it to a fairy tale, the fairy tale crowd.
It's like, so who are your target audience?
Who's your target audience?
And it's gotten worse as the seasons have gone on.
The only season that I don't think was that crazy, I think, was the one where King George.
Yes.
That one about the
because I think the theme was more mental health anyway.
Yeah, but so like every other season, like the most recent season, you're seeing.
I'm sorry, that one was actually a mess. You could see her bare. You know when I saw that, I actually had to fast forward because I thought, what the hell is going on here?
And it wasn't even a good season, to be fair. Woman watching that, and imagine like kids seeing.
But you know what they say now when they see it, they say liberation.
Yeah, liberation.
That's what I'm saying.
It's teaching kids. You know, maybe this is a safer way for them to access. No, it isn't. It isn't. Even like my friend, she was watching a documentary. I think it's called The Menendez Brothers on Netflix.
Oh, I've been watching that.
Yeah, and apparently it's really good. She said it's really good, but it's like, you know how usually, this is our, maybe can be our last point. Women have always maybe been exploited in media. Like they'll show a woman's bum, they'll show a woman's breast, they'll show a woman's body usually more than they would ever show a man. And apparently the Menendez Brothers is the first time, this my friend, she put it on her story. It's the first time she's ever seen a man's full frontal area on a show. On TV.
You're lying. Is this a documentary or the series?
It's a series. It's a series documentary.
So there's two on Netflix.
So there's a documentary. I've watched it. The series definitely shows a man's full body with his
penis. Like his actual penis is out. In like she put it on her Instagram story. Even when people do stuff like that as well, sorry, I love her, but in general, when people put stuff like vulgar stuff on their story, just
can you
casually,
put like a warning prior
just
to that?
Don't put it. Because people why should people see that?
Some people don't care.
It's wrong.
They don't care.
And like for me, it's like the fact that this is now on Netflix, anybody can go and watch that. A child could just be on their own at home.
Because I've watched it, funny enough, I watched that scene yesterday. Mm. And the first thing I did think about was how unnecessary it was. The point, whatever the point was that they were trying to make, that part was not necessary because it was a man in a shower. We can tell he's showering. So if you are showering, you are naked. We know that already. You did not need to show that. That's it.
I just think it's crazy.
But they know what they're doing. Like, they have to put it in there.
It was never normal to show people's full nakedness on TV. Mm. And it should not become normal. Because you're teaching kids about consent and you're teaching them about privacy. As a parent, that's what you're teaching them. You're telling them people shouldn't touch these areas of you. People shouldn't see these areas of you. Yet on TV,
they're seeing areas of people that they shouldn't see.
What message should they go
with? Are you trying to teach
contradicting
them?
Right.
Girls,
may God help us all.
May God, it was,
no, for real.
Really in the last days, I'm telling you.
Open your eyes, guys.
That is just what I feel. We're in the last days. How much? I feel like it's gonna keep getting worse.
Of course, if this is where we are,
and it's already terrible.
Imagine now, 5 years time, and whereas before you'd have parental guidance like pins on like Skybox. I don't even think Netflix has that. It's either you just create a kid's account, but kids can easily switch from that account to the adult account. No password, no PIN, nothing.
Do you know what? Because we're not parents yet, sometimes I don't think about certain things, but parents have a lot of like, being a parent in this day and age
is a lot of responsibility
to being a parent back then. Because I remember the video of a woman or a voice message that was recorded, a conversation between a teacher and a student, and a teacher and a parent, sorry. And the mother was just saying how her daughter has rights if she doesn't want to participate in something to do with like the LGBT community or something to do with Halloween. She doesn't have to, because based on her faith, based what she's taught at home, she's not interested in doing those things, and she has every right to do so. And the teacher stood on the leg of discrimination, like she should be able to be, you know, to speak to the other kids and just get involved in that. And her parents said, what are you teaching these kids? And I can't believe this is even a conversation to have, you know, because we're not parents. I can't even imagine if I'm ever a parent and someone wants to tell me that my kid I would lose it, because what are you telling me here? Because exactly?
In one breath you're teaching my child that they should have boundaries, yet at the same time, if the school thinks it's fine to violate those boundaries, then now my child is a discriminatory person. So
like what
these are the same people that would say freedom of speech. Oh, but not that speech.
That's
though.
How you know they're driving a the narrative. Not there's that only speech. One way or because no
if
way
we don't agree with you, then now we're the bad people. Anyway,
it don't be making sense. I'm telling you,
think about your life.
Think about it. That's give your life to Jesus.
Yes, that's all I can say to you tonight.
There's only one.
Wow.
Yeah. We'll see you next week, guys.
Bye.
Bye.
Hey. No, because there's actually only one way.
No, sorry to tell you, there is. Not sorry.